Welcome back to another edition of We Rise Fighting Labor Podcast. We bring you today's labor news, history, and analysis from the U.S. and around the world. This is a podcast you listen to with your fellow workers organizing on the shop floor. This is a podcast you listen to before walking into your union meeting. As always, I'm Rick Urrutia, here with my co-host, Brian Pfeiffer. We cover a lot of ground in this episode of We Rise Fighting Labor Podcast. Everything from an update on Palestine to remembering Dr. King's legacy. Also, an illegal teacher's strike in Massachusetts, Educators for Palestine, a statement of solidarity with Palestine from Milwaukee AFSCME Local 526. Also, we look at Yemen, Namibia, the Teamsters, South Africa, and even COSATU. So please stay tuned and check out this song called Bring Back Nelson Mandela by Hugh Masekela.
Today on We Rise Fighting, we honor and celebrate Dr. Martin Luther King and Mrs. King and their families that contributed so much to the people's freedom struggle. Winning the Dr. King federal holiday was a protracted years-long battle supported and led by Mrs. Coretta Scott King, Miss Gladys Knight, Miss Diana Ross, Brother Gil Scott Heron, Mr. Quincy Jones, Mr. Harry Belafonte, Santana, and many, many others. The organizing included a variety of support from numerous worker and community organizations, including many unions such as SEIU Local 1199 and ILWU Local 10 across the U.S. and beyond. Mr. Stevie Wonder's song, Happy Birthday, was the anthem of the movement to demand the federal holiday. Numerous protest actions took place to win the day, including a January 15, 1981 diverse action of at least 25,000 at the National Mall in Washington, D.C., where participants marched from the Capitol to the Washington Monument. The demand for a federal holiday began in 1968 and was first signed into law after repeated protests by Ronald Reagan in 83, but the day wasn't officially observed until 1986. According to NPR, there were still several holdouts who refused to recognize the holiday at the state level. Most notably, Arizona opposed it until a referendum was passed in 1992 after the state lost an estimated $500 million in revenue. When the NFL, under pressure from the players' union and others, moved the 1993 Super Bowl game to California in protest. We at We Rise Fighting are inspired by Dr. King in many ways, especially these two quotes. We'll start off with Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s Beyond Vietnam, A Time to Break Silence at Riverside Church in New York City on April 4th, 1967. This is a direct quote from Dr. King's speech. Quote, our only hope today lies in our ability to recapture the revolutionary spirit and go out into a sometimes hostile world, declaring eternal hostility to poverty, racism, and militarism. With this powerful commitment, we shall boldly challenge the status quo and unjust mores and thereby speed the day when every valley shall be exalted and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight and the rough places plain. Now let us begin. Now let us rededicate ourselves to the long and bitter, but beautiful struggle for a new world, end quote. Another quote from Dr. King comes from Memphis, where he was murdered in April 1968, speaking at the Mason Temple Church of God in Christ headquarters on April 3rd, 1968. Reverend King in his I've Been to the Mountaintop speech, said, quote, "Just as I say, we aren't going to let any dogs or water hoses turn us around. We aren't going to let any injunction turn us around. We are going on. We need all of you," end quote. And Dr. King was there in Memphis to support the striking sanitation workers, 1,300 of them on strike, which eventually won recognition in a union contract. And Dr. King gave his life for those workers and many more. So, Rick, we've talked a lot about our thoughts here at We Rise Fighting about injunctions and all the other tricks and legal mechanisms the bosses try to tie us up in. What's your response to Dr. King's words here about injunctions and defying them?
You know, Brian, it just reminds me of just last week's episode, even the postal workers who went on wildcat strike. 200,000 postal workers in 1970 in the U.S. went on a wildcat strike, meaning a strike that wasn't authorized by the state. It didn't have the blessing of the union leadership, didn't have the recognition of the bosses. It was just a wildcat strike of 200,000 postal workers going on strike. And the court was filing injunctions against them. And like I was saying, you know, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? You have 200,000 people on strike. What are you going to do with that piece of paper injunction? The idea here isn't so much what's legal and what's illegal. Like, it's not whether a strike is legal or is illegal. It's a matter of how we as working class people are going to get away with it. That's the real question. And that's actually what I have on my plate right now is an article from Labor Notes magazine, which I recommend. You know, if you're following this, that's another good resource to have. And one of the articles that they put out this week on January 11th is titled "Massachusetts Teachers' Illegal Strike Wave Rolls On." That's right, illegal strike wave. So here, this is what the article is telling us. A wildly successful illegal three-day strike by the Andover Education Association in November has reverberated statewide for educators in Massachusetts. The lowest paid instructional assistants got a 60% wage jump immediately. Classroom aides on the higher end of the scale got a 37% increase. Members won paid family medical leave, an extra personal day, fewer staff meetings, and the extension of lunch and recess times for elementary students. Andover is 20 miles north of Boston, and the strike involved 10 schools. For 10 months and 27 bargaining sessions, the Andover School Committee had insisted that none of these demands was possible. But by the end of the first day of the strike, they had ceded many items. By day three, they agreed to almost all of the union's demands. Public school workers can't legally strike in Massachusetts, but Andover's is just one of a series of school unions that have struck over the last 4 years, defying the ban, and in some cases, paying heavy fines as a result. The Massachusetts Teacher Association is pushing for legislation that would legalize public sector strikes after 6 months of bargaining. So those are my thoughts. You know, they're getting away with it. After 3 days, they had that many gains. I mean, that's how this really works. You know, it's not a matter of whether something is illegal or not. It's how we're going to get away with it. You know, for the bosses, the questions of labor law are a different question. It's how much it's going to cost them, you know, how much to break the law, essentially, and smash the union. For us, when we're talking about how we're going to break the law, how we're going to break labor law, the question is, how are we going to get away with it? So hats off to Massachusetts teachers. We will keep you up to date on that. Now, moving forward to Brian again, we're going to continue our coverage of Palestine, as we will continue to do moving forward. And he's also going to talk to us about the Martin Luther King Day March in Detroit. So let's hear all about it, Brian.
Thanks, Rick. The website laborforpalestine.net, that's laborforpalestine.net, has a variety of information about union members opposing the U.S.-Israel genocidal apartheid. Actions include links to union resolutions and reporting on events like the Free Palestine labor contingents at the National March on Washington, D.C., January 13th, 2024, where unions such as the SEIU, Service Employees International Union, and the United Electrical Worker members and other union members participated. This week, we're going to report on four major developments in regard to Palestine and unions. The first is today, January 15th, Dr. King Day, in Detroit at the 21st annual Detroit MLK event. United Auto Workers President Shawn Fain gave a powerful social justice speech, which is available on their social media, about unions and called for a U.S.-Israel ceasefire in regard to Palestine. Other speakers included many social justice fighters, such as Congresswoman Rashida Tlaib, Black and Brown Freedom Struggle participants, and some of those we've interviewed on We Rise Fighting, including Frank Hammer, UAW retiree and former union president, and Abiyami Azakiwe, a co-founder of Detroit MLK and the Moratorium Now Coalition, and also a co-chair of this year's 21st annual Detroit event. The entire program is available for viewing at the Detroit MLK Facebook page. We also have a clip right here from Brother Shawn Fain.
Today, we find our government backing destruction of lives and villages, not in Vietnam, but in Gaza. We hear the boosters of war claiming that real patriots support the bombing. But we know in this room that there is nothing more patriotic than the pursuit of justice, no matter where that takes us.
All right, Rick, you talked about educators tonight, and they are continuing not only their strikes, but also demanding ceasefires and endorsements and a variety of other activity happening for Palestine in support of Palestine by educators across the country. Tell us about that, Rick.
You know, yeah, this group, Educators for Palestine, just released an announcement talking about a march, an education solidarity rally that will take place on February 10th in Washington, D.C. And they're calling on members of the American Federation of Teachers and the National Education Association to participate. And, you know, this one is pretty interesting, Brian, because they're saying no ceasefire for starters. You know, it's not typical for education unions to come out against the war, unless I'm grossly mistaken. That's not something that I've heard much of. So step number one is pretty cool. And then the second part is that they're saying no endorsement, as in presidential endorsement for 2024, which you don't often see that. So this is a doubleheader here. This is pretty interesting. So Educators Solidarity Rally, February 10th for Palestine at 11 a.m. in Washington, D.C. And that's, again, a call for NEA and AFT members, as well as any other unions, to revoke Biden's endorsement until he can support a permanent ceasefire in Gaza and the end of occupation in Palestine. For more information, you can go on their Instagram, and their Instagram is at educatorsforpalestine_NEA, the letters NEA for National Education Association. Next up, we have Brian again talking about Milwaukee AFSCME Local 526 and solidarity from nurses. What's going on there, Brian?
Rick, in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, AFSCME Local 526, that's the American Federation of State, County, and Municipal Employees, stands with the Palestinian people against genocide. This is a resolution passed by the local this past week. These workers work at the Milwaukee Museum in downtown Milwaukee, and their resolution we are going to read in its entirety here, because we feel at We Rise Fighting this is perhaps one of the best resolutions that we've seen so far. There's been many across the country, from San Francisco to the East Coast as well, and everywhere in between. As Rick just talked about, the educators have led a variety of resolutions, and this one is similar to that. So it says, AFSCME Local 526 stands with the Palestinian people against genocide. AFSCME Local 526 dedicates itself to improving the lives of working people and fighting for a world where all people can live with dignity, justice, respect, peace, and equality. We consistently stand against Islamophobia, anti-Semitism, and racism in all its forms. We stand in solidarity with the Palestinian people, Palestinian trade unions, anti-Zionist Jewish people, and millions of others who are demanding an end to Israel's colonial violence and genocide. We condemn the active role of the U.S. government in supporting Israel's system of occupation and apartheid, illegal settlements, and forced displacement of Palestinians, which is the root cause of the conflict. The resolution continues. We mourn all loss of life resulting from the conflict and call for an immediate end to Israel's aggression against Gaza that has killed over 23,000 Palestinians and displaced 85% of Gaza's population, 1.9 million people. U.S. support for Israel's war has caused a humanitarian disaster and is risking a deadly outbreak of famine, disease, and a wider war. The billions of U.S. tax dollars spent on weapons for Israel every year should be reallocated to fund programs that help poor and working people like healthcare, education, and childcare. AFSCME Local 526 commits to taking the following actions in support of peace and justice. One, we will send letters to our congressional representatives asking them to endorse bills such as H.R. 3103 and others that take meaningful action to end the genocide and occupation. Two, we will join over 900 unions, governments, and popular organizations who have endorsed South Africa's Genocide Convention against Israel at the UN International Court of Justice. Three, we will petition our employer, the Milwaukee Public Museum, to correct the large map in the Crossroads of Civilization gallery that includes a label for Israel, but not Palestine. Four, we will send a copy of this resolution to AFSCME leadership, encouraging them to join the many union internationals who have already called for a ceasefire. Five, we will continue to support and participate in actions led by the Wisconsin Coalition for Justice in Palestine, Wisconsin Labor for Palestine, Jewish Voice for Peace, the Milwaukee Anti-War Committee, and others, passed unanimously at the AFSCME Local 526 membership meeting on January 11th, 2024. And that's the end of the resolution, a powerful resolution there. And the Labor for Palestine was mentioned in this resolution, listeners, and that is a part of the Wisconsin Coalition for Justice in Palestine, which now has a Labor for Palestine contingent that marched in the historic statewide march in Madison on December 9th and has continued to have various actions, including joining protests at companies in Wisconsin that make products for Israel. Next up, the nurses call for action in solidarity with Palestine. And their name is Union Nurses for Palestine. And they have a bit of an excerpt from their statement. As the strongest nursing union in America, CNA, NNU, NNOC must join the call to stand with Palestine. We are witnessing a genocide unfolding in real time. As nurses, we follow the Nursing Code of Ethics. The ethics we live by have four main principles: autonomy, beneficence, justice, and non-malfeasance. To call for the liberation of the Palestinian people and to demand that the union stand beside the Palestinian people is deeply rooted in our nursing code of ethics. Palestine deserves to live free from this endless violence and displacement from their native land. We have committed our lives to these principles, and so long as we have a collective voice, we will demand a free Palestine. Our call for Palestinian liberation is an extension of our commitment to justice, and if we are silent, we are complicit in the genocide. We hope that CNA, NNU, NNOC stands with us in unwaveringly supporting the liberation of the Palestinian people, because doing so is imperative to our union's anti-imperialist racial justice values that we claim to uphold. The statement ends. So supporters of this can sign a statement and also go to the Labor for Palestine website and find this statement, sign the statement that the nurses put forward, as well as joining the Union Nurses for Palestine at their website.
All right, switching gears a little bit to the international news, we're going to turn our attention to South Africa and South Africa charging Israel with genocide in the International Court of Justice. To get us all up to date a little bit, Germany has stepped in and basically tried to vouch for Israel, trying to say, you know, actually that's not genocide. And Namibia, is a nation that's stepping in, an African nation that's stepping in and condemning Germany for defending Israel in the ICJ genocide case. All right, this article is from Al Jazeera, and I found it useful because it gives us the historical background as well as an understanding of the different entities involved, the different bodies involved. And the article is actually called Namibia Condemns Germany for Defending Israel in ICJ Genocide Case. Namibia has criticized Germany's shocking decision to support Israel in the genocide case at the International Court of Justice brought by South Africa as Israel's war on Gaza entered its 100th day. Quote, Germany has chosen to defend in the ICJ the genocidal and gruesome acts of the Israeli government against innocent civilians in Gaza and the occupied Palestinian territories, unquote, the president of Namibia, Hage Geingob, said in a statement on X on Saturday. A two-day public hearing in the case at the World Court, the highest legal body of the United Nations, took place on Thursday and Friday, during which South Africa and Israel presented their arguments. South Africa told the court on Thursday that Israel's aerial and ground offensive, which has laid waste to much of the enclave and killed almost 24,000 people, according to Gaza health authorities, aimed to bring about the quote-unquote destruction of the population of Gaza. Israel accused South Africa of presenting a quote-unquote distorted view of the hostilities, denying that its military operation in Gaza is a state-led genocide campaign against Palestinians. The statement by the Namibian president added that Berlin was ignoring Israel's killing of more than 23,000 Palestinians in Gaza, and various United Nations reports disturbingly highlighted the internal displacement of 85% of the besieged enclave's 2.3 million people amid acute shortages of food and essential services. The Namibian president expressed quote-unquote deep concern over the shocking decision communicated by the government of Germany on Friday, in which it rejected the morally upright indictment brought forward by South Africa. No peace-loving human being can ignore the carnage waged against Palestinians in Gaza, it said. The statement claimed that Germany committed the first genocide of the 20th century in Namibia between 1904 and 1908, in which tens of thousands of innocent Namibians died in the most inhumane and brutal conditions. Germany cannot morally express commitment to the United Nations Convention Against Genocide, including atonement for the genocide in Namibia, whilst supporting the equivalent of a Holocaust and genocide in Gaza, the presidency said. President Geingob appeals to the German government to reconsider its untimely decision to intervene as a third party in defense and support of the genocidal acts of Israel before the International Court of Justice. As far as atrocities in Namibia, German colonial forces carried out atrocities in Namibia against the indigenous Herero and Nama peoples between 1904 and 1908. The killings were part of a German campaign of collective punishment between 1904 and 1908 that is today recognized as the 20th century's first genocide. Henning Melber from Nordic Africa Institute in Sweden said that the statement issued by President Geingob was an unexpected turning point in the already fragile German-Namibian relations. Germany publicly took side on the ICJ case with Israel on January 12th, which marks 120 years of the beginning of what many Namibians call the German-Namibian War, which then resulted in the first genocide of the 20th century, he said. While Germany scored a lot of good points internationally in the way it engaged with the mass destruction of the Holocaust, it was in denial of the genocide committee with Namibia in 2015, Melber said. He added that the German and the Namibian governments have been in negotiations on the Namibian genocide for the past 8 years. He said Germany still falls short of recognizing the incidents in Namibia as a genocide in legal terms, which means it refuses the obligations to pay reparations. The ICJ is likely to present a provisional measure in the coming days, but a final verdict will take years. South Africa has urged the court to order an immediate halt to Israel's devastating military offensive in Gaza. The 1948 Genocide Convention, enacted in the wake of the mass murder of Jews in the Nazi Holocaust, defines genocide as, quote, acts committed with intent to destroy in whole or in part a national, ethnical, racial, or religious group, unquote. South Africa filed the ICJ case on December 19th, accusing Israel of genocidal acts in Gaza. Several countries and international organizations have backed South Africa in its case, while Israel has received the backing of the United States, its main weapon supplier and close ally. Several global entities, including Human Rights Watch, have determined that Israel is engaging in war crimes in Gaza. So that's the report from Namibia, and, you know, also speaks to what's happening with South Africa, Germany, and Israel. We'll have a little bit more on South Africa towards the end of the show. For now, we're going to switch gears again a little bit. We're going to talk about the Labor Notes Conference and the UNAC Conference. What's going on there, Brian?
Minneapolis on April 5th to 7th, 2024, Rick. There will be the United National Anti-War Coalition Conference. The title is Decolonization and the Fight Against Imperialism. Their description for the event says, quote, as we have seen the horrific events in Gaza and the imperialist debacle in Ukraine, the United States pushes ahead with threats aimed at China and any country that will not accept its domination. Now is the time for us to come together as a movement to assess the period we are in and plan for the future. The event will be at the Intercontinental St. Paul Riverfront Hotel, located on East Kellogg Boulevard in St. Paul, Minnesota, April 5th to 7th, 2024. More information is available at unacpeace.org. That's UNAC. PEACE.org. Another very important conference in April, and we mentioned one of the articles today, is the Labor Notes Conference in Chicago, April 19th to the 21st, 2024. That's April 19th to the 21st this year. Labor Notes on its website says, join thousands of union members, officers, and labor activists who are on the front lines in our workplaces and our communities, organizing new workers and agitating together. There will be more than 200 meetings and workshops organized with others in your union, industry, or campaign. To register, information on how to table, hotel information, and more, go to labornotes.org. That's labornotes, one word, .org. And Rick, you've been to Labor Notes conferences before. What's your experience been at these conferences?
I love the Labor Notes conference. You know, you got trade unions coming in from around the world. You know, I remember at one Labor Notes conference sitting at a table with trade unionists from El Salvador, Mexico, Chile, Peru, Bolivia. Like, that was pretty badass. That's the kind of experience that you can have there, you know, and of course from all around the world. So you also have trade unionists from Asian nations, from European nations. In truth, I haven't seen many, if any, from African nations, but you get the idea. And, you know, that's just something that as a trade unionist, you want to be a part of. You can see the internationalism happen before your eyes and, you know, at the very least for making that human connection, you know. So I definitely encourage people to go to the Labor Notes Conference if you've never been to it. The workshops are also really useful. You know, people just sharing tips about how they've won strikes, the type of research they do, you know, coordinating campaigns, stuff like that. It also, going back on the international tip, you know, it gives you an appreciation for how other unions go about organizing and striking and dealing with the bosses. You know, it helps you think outside the box, gives you new ideas, you know, and that's always helpful. Just a reminder, folks, you know, we're living in the U.S. here. This is capitalism central. This is the belly of the beast. You know, we've been indoctrinated and everything from Cold War hysteria to anti-unionism to McCarthyism to a Red Scare to all that stuff for generations now. So if you can undo some of that stuff by doing something like going to the Labor Notes Conference and meeting trade unionists from around the world, man, you're better off. So definitely highly recommend going to the Labor Notes Conference. And staying on that international tip, just an update from Yemen. So people are current on this. And these are just some bullet points I took from a Democracy Now! Report that I heard today. And just to put it on the record so people are up to date, the U.S. and Britain have carried out dozens of military strikes against Yemen, and that began on Thursday night. Strikes were carried out from land and sea, and the U.S. says that the strikes came in response to Houthi attacks on ships in the Red Sea to protest Israel's attacks on Gaza. Calling the strikes barbaric, the Houthi says it will continue targeting ships headed towards Israel. Yemen has been targeted by U.S. military actions and bombings over the course of the last four presidencies in the U.S. That's George W. Bush, Barack Obama, Donald Trump, and now Joe Biden. So this is relatively new news. So we will keep you up to date also on what's going on with Yemen, along with Palestine and a general anti-war report. And speaking of anti-war, because fascists just love war, let's resist that. So what's the resist fascism statement, Brian? Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, thanks, Rick. There's been a variety of calls. One is at the Fighting Words website. The title is Organize Now for a Working Class Resistance to Fascism. Again, that's Organize Now for a Working Class Resistance to Fascism, and that's published on the Fighting Words website. We're going to read just a few paragraphs from this call because it's very critical and very important, especially in this period. It starts off by saying, starting now, progressive sources should begin building support among unionists and the many millions of unorganized workers for a general strike to confront any widespread suppression of people's rights by a Trump presidency. The starting point should be to contact the unions and central labor councils who, in 2020, threatened a general strike if Trump tried to carry out a coup to stay in office. The statement continues, the second area of focus should be to direct an appeal to U.S. military personnel, especially rank-and-file soldiers, to be prepared to refuse illegal orders. And that was done in the Vietnam War, of course, and many other times in U.S. history. The statement continues, the third organizing effort should be for progressive organizations to build defense units, to protect union and community meetings, rallies, and protests. These popular security committees should be prepared to use all reasonable methods to carry out their assignments. Most unions have sergeant at arms to maintain order. This can be expanded if necessary by including members of union veteran committees and other committees. Depending on the police, to defend democratic rights will be a fatal error. Only organizing among poor and working people will allow independent working class action. Such organizing on a national level will also give pause to the ultra-right elements of the ruling class who are financing and encouraging the Trump movement. After all, the very last thing they want is an independent, militant, and organized working class. And even if the Democratic Party candidate does win the 2024 election, it would still be useful to have an independent mass national organization of poor and working people to forcefully promote a working class agenda that the Democrats fall short of implementing. See the full call at fighting-words.net. That's fighting-words, WORDS.net, fightingwords.net. All right, Rick, what do you have next?
All right, so again, in honor of Dr. Martin Luther King Day, I went around, checked out different unions' websites. As y'all already know, I look for press releases. And today I found a press release from the Teamsters celebrating Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday. And I just wanted to read that, and I wanted to highlight that just to encourage other unions to do the same. The press release reads as follows. Teamsters celebrate Martin Luther King Jr.'s struggle for civil rights and workers' rights. The Teamsters are proud to honor Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s legacy of fighting for civil rights and workers' rights on January 15th, 2024. King, an honorary Teamster member, gave his life in 1968 while standing alongside striking sanitation workers in Memphis, Tennessee. With the help of strong unions, much progress has been made for workers in the years following Dr. King's work, but the fight for higher wages and better working conditions for all workers continues. The Teamsters remain committed to continuing Dr. King's fight for social and economic justice for workers and their families across North America. Last year, the Teamsters channeled King's dream of worker dignity at the bargaining table during national contract negotiations with UPS. In the historic 2023 to 2028 UPS agreement, workers secured several prominent wins, including receiving Martin Luther King Day as a paid holiday for the first time. Through the work of the Teamsters Human Rights and Diversity Commission, our union will continue to carry on the legacy of Dr. King. So hats off to the Teamsters for putting that out front and center, for putting out a press release about Dr. Martin Luther King's Dr. Martin Luther King Day. You know, the unions being in part an integral part of social movements, that's nothing new. All right, that's something that we have seen many times in the US. And because we're also on the subject of South Africa, You know, that's something that we saw in a South African union called COSATU. They were one of the main engines. They were one of the main social forces in the anti-apartheid struggle in South Africa. And we just wanted to highlight that and remind you of that and just remind you that unions aren't just bread and butter issues. It's not just wages and healthcare and pay days off. It can be and should be part of a broader social movement. Okay, today we're going to leave you off with an excerpt from the International Court of Justice. This is the South African legal team presenting its case of genocide against the Israeli defense team. And we present this because the corporate media, the bourgeois media, the capitalist media, whatever you want to call it, the mainstream media has been omitting the part from the South African legal team and only playing the part from the Israeli defense team. So we're going to leave you off with that. Thank you always for listening. If you like our show, please go ahead and subscribe, like, share, talk about whatever your thing is. But please go ahead and keep chiming in. Thank you always. Love and solidarity to all. We'll leave you with this excerpt from the International Court of Justice.
And I now invite Ms. Adila Hasim to address the court. You have the floor, madam.
Thank you. Madam President, distinguished members of the court, it is a privilege to appear on behalf of the Republic of South Africa in this case of exceptional importance. It's a case that underscores the very essence of our shared humanity as expressed in the preamble to the Genocide Convention. It's my task to address the court on the genocidal acts that have led to this urgent request for provisional measures under Article 41 of the Statute of the Court. South Africa contends that Israel has transgressed Article 2 of the Convention by committing actions that fall within the definition of genocide. The actions show a systematic pattern of conduct from which genocide can be inferred. Allow me to place these acts in context. Gaza is one of the two constituent territories of the occupied Palestinian territories, occupied by Israel since 1967. It is a narrow strip of approximately 365 square kilometers, as depicted in the map now displayed. Israel continues to exercise control over the space, territorial waters, land crossings, water, electricity, electromagnetic sphere, and civilian infrastructure in Gaza, as well as over key governmental functions. As the Honourable Minister has said, entry and exit by air and sea to Gaza is prohibited, with Israel operating the only two crossing points. Gaza, which is one of the most densely populated places in the world, is home to approximately 2.3 million Palestinians, almost half of them children. For the past 96 days, Israel has subjected Gaza to what has been described as one of the heaviest conventional bombing campaigns in the history of modern warfare. Palestinians in Gaza are being killed by Israeli weaponry and bombs from air, land, and sea. They are also at immediate risk of death by starvation, dehydration, and disease as a result of the ongoing siege by Israel, the destruction of Palestinian towns, the insufficient aid being allowed through to the Palestinian population, and the impossibility of distributing this limited aid while bombs fall. This conduct renders essentials to life unobtainable. At this provisional measures stage, as this court has made clear in the Gambia-Myanmar case, it is not necessary for the court to come to a final view on the question of whether Israel's conduct constitutes genocide. It is necessary to establish only whether at least some of the acts alleged are capable of falling within the provisions of the Convention. On analyzing the specific and ongoing genocidal acts complained of, it is clear that at least some, if not all of these acts, fall within the Convention's provisions. These acts are documented in detail in South Africa's application and confirmed by reliable, often UN, sources. It's thus unnecessary and impossible for me to recount all of them. I will highlight only some in order to illustrate the pattern of genocidal conduct. The UN statistics that are relied upon are up to date as of 9 January 2024. In South Africa's oral submissions, we will illustrate the facts that we rely on with limited use of audiovisual material. Madam President, we do so with restraint and only where necessary, and always with respect to the Palestinian people. Against this background, I move now to demonstrate, in turn, how Israel's conduct violates Articles 2A, 2B, 2C, and 2D of the Convention. The first genocidal act committed by Israel is the mass killing of Palestinians in Gaza, in violation of Article 2A of the Genocide Convention. As the UN Secretary General explained 5 weeks ago, the level of Israel's killing is so extensive that nowhere is safe in Gaza. As I stand before you today, 23,210 Palestinians have been killed by Israeli forces during the sustained attacks over the last 3 months, at least 70% of whom are believed to be women and children. Some 7,000 Palestinians are still missing, presumed dead under the rubble. Palestinians in Gaza are subjected to relentless bombing wherever they go. They are killed in their homes, in places where they seek shelter, in hospitals, in schools, in mosques, in churches, and as they try to find food and water for their families. They have been killed if they failed to evacuate in the places to which they have fled, and even while they attempted to flee along Israeli-declared safe routes. The level of killing is so extensive that those whose bodies are found are buried in mass graves, often unidentified. In the first 3 weeks alone, following 7 October, Israel deployed 6,000 bombs per week. At least 200 times it has deployed 2,000-pound bombs in southern areas of Palestine designated as safe. These bombs have also decimated the north, including refugee camps. 2,000-pound bombs are some of the biggest and most destructive bombs available. They are dropped by lethal fighter jets that are used to strike targets on the ground by one of the world's most resourced armies. Israel has killed an unparalleled and unprecedented number of civilians, with the full knowledge of how many civilian lives each bomb will take. More than 1,800 families, Palestinian families in Gaza, have lost multiple family members, and hundreds of multi-generational families have been wiped out, with no remaining survivors, mothers, fathers, children, siblings, grandparents, aunts, cousins, often all killed together. This killing is nothing short of destruction of Palestinian life. It is inflicted deliberately. No one is spared, not even newborn babies. The scale of Palestinian child killings in Gaza is such that UN chiefs have described it as a graveyard for children. The devastation, we submit, is intended to and has laid waste to Gaza beyond any acceptable, legal, let alone humane, justification. The second genocidal act identified in South Africa's application is Israel's infliction of serious bodily or mental harm to Palestinians in Gaza in violation of Article 2B of the Genocide Convention. Israel's attacks have left close to 60,000 Palestinians wounded and maimed. Again, the majority of them women and children. This in circumstances where the healthcare system has all but collapsed. I return to this later in my speech. Large numbers of Palestinian civilians, including children, are arrested, blindfolded, forced to undress, and loaded onto trucks taken to unknown locations. The suffering of the Palestinian people, physical and mental, is undeniable. Turning to the third genocidal act under Article 2C, Israel has deliberately imposed conditions on Gaza that cannot sustain life and are calculated to bring about its physical destruction. Israel achieves this in at least four ways. First, by displacement. Israel has forced the displacement of about 85% of Palestinians in Gaza. There is nowhere safe for them to flee to. Those who cannot leave or refuse to be displaced have either been killed or at extreme risk of being killed in their homes. Many Palestinians have been displaced multiple times as families are forced to move repeatedly in search of safety. Israel's first evacuation order on 13 October required the evacuation of over 1 million people, including children, the elderly, the wounded, and infirm. Entire hospitals were required to evacuate, even newborn babies in intensive care. The order required them to evacuate the north to the south within 24 hours. The order itself was genocidal. It required immediate movement, taking only what could be carried, while no humanitarian assistance was permitted, and fuel, water, and food, and other necessities of life had deliberately been cut off. It was clearly calculated to bring about the destruction of the population. For many Palestinians, the forced evacuation from their homes is inevitably permanent. Israel has now damaged or destroyed an estimated 355,000 Palestinian homes, leaving at least 500,000 Palestinians with no home to return to. The Special Rapporteur on the Human Rights of Internally Displaced Persons explains that houses and infrastructure, quote, have been razed to the ground, frustrating any realistic prospects for displaced Gazans to return home, repeating a long history of mass forced displacement of Palestinians by Israel. There is no indication at all that Israel accepts responsibility for rebuilding what it has destroyed. Instead, the destruction is celebrated by the Israeli army. Soldiers film themselves joyfully detonating entire apartment blocks and town squares, erecting the Israeli flag over the wreckage, seeking to re-establish Israeli settlements on the rubble of Palestinian homes, and thus extinguishing the very basis of Palestinian life in Gaza. Second, together with the forced displacement, Israel's conduct has been deliberately calculated to cause widespread hunger, dehydration, and starvation. Israel's campaign has pushed Gazans to the brink of famine. An unprecedented 93% of the population in Gaza is facing crisis levels of hunger. Of all the people in the world currently suffering catastrophic hunger, more than 80% are in Gaza. The situation is such that the experts are now predicting that more Palestinians in Gaza may die from starvation and disease than airstrikes. And yet Israel continues to impede the effective delivery of humanitarian assistance to Palestinians, not only refusing to allow sufficient aid in, but removing the ability to distribute it through constant bombardment and obstruction. Just 3 days ago, on 8 January, a planned mission by UN agencies to deliver urgent medical supplies and vital fuel to a hospital and medical supply center was denied by Israeli authorities. This marked the fifth denial of a mission to the center since 26 December, leaving five hospitals in northern Gaza without access to life-saving medical supplies and equipment. Aid trucks that are allowed in are seized upon by the hungry. What is provided is simply not enough.